can you? Brother Robert's text, as Brother Aaron has already said, is Isaiah 43:25. I, even I, am he that blotteth out thy transgressions for mine own sake, and I will not remember thy sins. I wanted to look at the word blot. God is the only one who can blot something out completely. When something is blotted out, this is done with, it's usually with like a fountain pen or some sort of really wet ink. And it's usually done while the ink is still wet. You use a clean absorbent cloth to just kind of soak up what you can. Now the problem is that when we soak something up, there's still a stain. It's always there. It's a stain. But when God does it, it's completely removed. And there's no indication that it was ever written down. Yeah. So this is done for mine own sake. And this is for God, because he is holy. And you can't be in the presence of God if you have sin in your life. And this is why he has completely blotted it out. Now I'm going to let Brother Bob come and expound the text. I, even I, am he that blotteth out thy transgressions for my own sake, and will not remember thy sins.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Anita. Blotting. Something needs to be removed when you blot something, doesn't it? Yeah. I'm very thankful that the Lord has saw fit to blot out our transgressions. But if we see the bigger picture, we'll see that it was for his own sake. He has a purpose that demands that our sins be blotted out. Isn't that salvation to us? That's salvation. He took away your sin. You look, somebody brings me something good. I don't ask. I don't question their motives. Say, what do you do good to me for? God did good to us. And when we see it, we will appreciate it more when we see that he did it for his own namesake than if he just did it for me personally. See, but we're part of something big here. I, even I, am he that blotteth out thy transgressions for my own sake, and I might not remember your sins. I will not. I will not remember your sins. Well, then I don't want to remember them either. He's the great I am. Now, we already went over this a little bit. A few of the brethren already walked this path, so I'll just briefly mention this. Remember, he told Moses, I am that I am. We had a whole sermon on it. We ought to really be holding on to that pretty firmly now. This is the one that's talking. He says it like this to get your attention. I, even I. Oh, this is better. Pick up your ears. Perk them up. The great I am's getting ready to talk. This is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I, even out. And now, I, even I is found 19 times in the King James translation of the scriptures, and 13 times it's used like it is in our text. In other words, God is saying it. I'm the one that's talking now. Remember he said to Noah, God told Noah, I, even I, bring a flood upon the earth. God was getting ready to do something. It wasn't no mistake. This was just a catastrophe. Well, it was a catastrophe. But God wanted it known that he was the one that brought it. I'm going to bring a flood on the earth. God told, I'm just going to skip through all that. I've done enough of that. It's God himself that looks out across the chasm of time and space, across the Milky Way and everything that he had created. And he comes to a conclusion. He shares this with us in Isaiah 44:6. Thus saith the Lord, the King of Israel, and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am first and I am last. And beside me, There is no God. Amen. We're going to talk for a few minutes about the one true God, this one that can say, I, and whatever comes next, well, you really better be paying attention, because this is something really important. Yeah. You know, only 13 times did he address a certain subject like this. Now, you know, men of the earth have seen this to some degree. I'm talking about wicked men of the earth. Nebuchadnezzar, the leader of the most illustrious world-dominating kingdoms of men ever in the earth. Remember, he was that golden head. God made him so. This is the words he spoke after the three Hebrew children came out of the fire. He wasn't talking like this before he put them in the fire. But after they come out, he kind of had a different opinion of their God. This is what he said. There is no other God that can deliver after this sort. Now, if I got to figure, if a wicked king can come to this conclusion just by witnessing something, then if God's working in you, if it's God that's working in you, both the do and the will of his good pleasure, then ought not you be able to reason like this? Is there anything too hard for God? If he can take away my sin, well, then I gotta depend that he's going to bring me to heaven. He's going to do that. It would seem to me like the hardest part's done. From my standpoint, see, I couldn't take away my sin. I was without hope and without God in the world. Just when God found me, I was out there doing whatever I wanted to do. Now that I'm in Christ, I don't seek to do what I want to do. What pleases him, this great I am. We serve the God that can just speak a word, just a single word. And can change your whole life forever. Remember, he said, someplace in the volume of the book, this is written, says, if you even touched him, if you could even touch him, you'd never be the same. Never. See, so this is the God. See, we really can't even approach this kind of a God, this holy, holy, holy God. We have to have an intercessor. Yeah. Otherwise, we'd just be consumed. Fire goes before him. You don't come just casually into the presence of this God. Well, when you start seeing who he is, it is a miracle that we weren't consumed previously. I. Brethren, if God takes away your sin, then it's gone. I mean, you say, well, that's kind of a simplistic statement. I like it when we can get it down to just like something we can get our teeth into. If God takes them away, then what am I out in the garbage can looking for them for? They're gone. Let them go. There's no one in heaven that can find them. There's anybody walking around heaven trying to seek an occasion against the brethren. Nobody. There's nobody in heaven saying, oh, I'm sure they'll mess up pretty soon. We'll have no. Heaven's for us. They're on our side. The angels, what? They're ministering spirits sent forth to those that shall be heirs of salvation. They're on your side. You got the angels on your side. And there's a company of angels, what you can't even number them all. There's a lot of them, and they're all on your side. See, God can just dispatch one. You're in trouble? We don't see it. Thank God we don't see it. But if you're in trouble, like on the way here, I got to figure an angel was dispatched. Right, there was a truck in front of me, and the thing flew off and headed right towards me, and it didn't hit me. Now, it could have. It could have. And I'd have had to be going to the hospital rather than going here. But see, no. God was in charge of that. He did it. There's no one on earth that can find your sin either. Now, so-and-so, he remembers when I sinned, but just tell him, God took him away. God took him away. I'm not the same man anymore that I used to be. God took my sin away. This is called a testimony. Someone comes up and they remember, say, oh, you want to go out reveling? No! God took my sin away. And I don't want to remember him anymore either. Now, I do want to make a distinction a little bit later about this, because, see, there's something about this that we need to understand. When a person sins, there is a certain amount of effect that it has on your life. God takes your sin away now. If you repent, he's faithful and just to take the sin away. But there are some circumstances that are going to be worked out in your life that's going to validate what God did. See, I'm one for saying that if God takes our sin away, then we should not be deceived into thinking that they're not. Now, we know we have an enemy, and that enemy, he's a liar. See, Lucifer, he's a liar. He's called the father of the lie. So see, when he comes to you and he'll remind you of something, well, see, you can use that opportunity. You can use that opportunity to say, wait, you're right. I did do that. But my God took it away. He took it away. What will happen is that you'll get confidence and he'll learn. I better not be messing around mentioning sins to this brother, because he gets all built up. See, Satan never brings up your old sins in order that you'll remember that they're gone. That isn't why he brought them up. He brings them up because he likes to make accusations. He's the accuser of the brother. Now, we want to be careful that we don't do his work for him. We want to be real careful that we don't cause an occasion for someone to be accused for something God forgave him of.
Amen.
Now, see, if the Holy Spirit, on the other hand, convicts us of sin, we're talking about our sins being blotted out. If the Holy Spirit convicts you of your sin, it's always in order that you'll run to Christ, beat a path to Christ, and Amen. Confess your sin. Let him know I sinned. I really did it. But I don't want to be carrying this sin around. We don't ever, ever, ever want to let sin live in our heart.
Amen.
Never. It'll defile you.
Yeah.
And it'll cause you, so from the moment you allow it to live there, a wedge will be driven between you and God.
Amen.
And the longer it's there, the bigger the wedge. And before you know it, you see, Satan will come and he'll say, oh, you didn't ask for forgiveness when you did that. And you knew you did it, but you didn't ask for forgiveness. See, now it just compounds. Now all of a sudden it's like, well, maybe God won't listen to me now. Maybe if I go now, he'll say, you should have come when you first knew. You see, all this line of reasoning all comes because you let sin live in your heart. No. If you're, the moment, see, this is why David was a man after God's own. The moment he knew, he said, I've sinned. Well, see, this is actually God's wanting us just to be real with him. Tell the truth. If you know you're a sinner, then just repent.
Well,
isn't this salvation custom made for us?
Amen.
This is custom made.
Amen.
God knows exactly who we are. He didn't need a testimony of who we are. He made us.
Yeah.
So, of course, he can provide the salvation for people like us. So, I mean, on one hand, you got Satan saying, oh, God ain't ever going to forgive you for your sin. And you got Jesus saying, if you'll just come and confess, I'll forgive you. The bottom line is, who are you going to believe? Who really are you gonna follow? You're gonna follow after the one who laid down his life for you, or the one that's trying to keep you from glory? Of course, it's not always that clear in the middle of the trial, is it? That's why we build ourselves up in our most holy faith, so we become strong to where we can endure. The removal of sin, I was trying to think of what I could parallel it to in the earth, and you know, there's a lot of different things you could say, but I thought of it like this. Kind of like a master surgeon. Now, this master surgeon, he's, you know, like 30 years been a surgeon. He knows all about surgery. And now he said, I'm going to attempt to put a man's head back on his body. Now, that would be an aggressive challenge, I think. We have this decapitated head. Now, we know the man's dead, but we're going to put it back together. And, well, that's a doomed project. They ain't never been able to do that, and as far as I know, they ain't never going to, because they can't breathe the breath of life back into the person. That's the problem. You know, everyone knows as soon as your head's lobbed off, you're done. You're done. I mean, you can live without a kidney. You can live without a leg, but you can't live without a head. I'm sorry. It's just not going to happen. So see, this is kind of like the way we were. We're trying to live under the law and trying to do it ourselves, and by works of righteousness, we found, I can't You know, I might be able to go, I could maybe sustain a whole hour. Now work start working, maybe I can do a whole week. I've never been able to do a whole week, but you see what I'm saying? There's to where you can, everything you did, every thought, every was 100% right. Well, see, what God gave us the law so we could understand. We needed a Savior. We need someone who can do this. Now, I do say, I don't believe God would have a problem at all reattaching somebody's head. I mean, if he can raise somebody from the dead that's been dead 4 days, he can definitely do whatever he wants to. Amen. If he can make man from the dust of the earth, well then, fixing him, this is not a problem. His physical constitution, he's never had a problem with that. He can just speak a word. But he didn't do that with sin, did he? He just didn't speak a word and say, all right, you're healed. Your sins are gone. No, see, this is much more intricate because God's has been violated. Sin has violated the nature of God. And this is much more difficult. There isn't any man besides the man Christ Jesus that could get this done. But he's like the master surgeon of salvation. He can step in. When the word became flesh, something new happened. There was never a man like Jesus on the earth. Never. He came, you know, men didn't think it was going to happen like this. No man could have sat down and figured out salvation and said, I think this is what God's going to do. No, he was born a babe, lying in a manger, and he was dependent on others to take care of him. In order for sin to be put away, Jesus, who knew no sin, would have to endure being made to be sin. We dealt some of this in our men's meeting. This would have to happen. God's justice would have to be vented. The wrath of God against sin, against iniquity. Well, it would have to be that God would have to judge sin in a man. Not in an angel, not in an animal. In a man. And this man would have to be, if we were going to be saved, perfect. In other words, he wasn't dying for his own self, but for our sins. First off, you got a problem because God himself looked. He looked out across humanity and he said, there's none righteous. No, not one. So we had a real dilemma. But God, before he ever made man, before he ever made the world, before he ever said, let there be light, Christ was a lamb slain from the foundation of the world. God had, he knew exactly what he was going to do. Now, I got to figure if God knew exactly what he was going to do down to the details of our salvation, then he would be able to determine who, what, and where everything happened in the whole earth. I mean, this is our God. He's not pretending. He's not practicing. You know, doctors, they practice. But God never practiced. God's worked salvation in the midst of the earth. Amen. What he's done. We've been given to know enough about what this transaction on the cross. See, we don't know everything. That's just the bottom line. We haven't been told every single involvement of what happened on the cross. Remember, for a space of 3 hours, it got dark. The sun refused to shine. And God laid the iniquity of us all on him, and Christ bore up under the sin of the whole world. And see, we don't know exactly. We're given enough information to know that God was pleased with it. There you read Isaiah 53. God was pleased. He made his soul an offering for sin, and he was pleased when he saw how his son bore up underneath that. He was pleased. Are you pleased with what Jesus did? God was pleased with it. Took away sin by the sacrifice of himself, and God was pleased. But see, the total involvements of our redemption and all the divine involvements and all the considerations and all the different aspects of the nature of God and his person and how this would impact heaven for all eternity, we don't know them yet. Well, I think we're going to get to know some more of it when we get to heaven. But see, now we know enough to trust in God that he took away our sins. He did. He took them away. They're gone. And see, now really, you think about it, knowing that, see, that's the big thing. I know that God took away my sin. Now, if you believe that, well then, see, sin, it'll lose its luster. Say, oh no, that sin cost the life of my Savior. He laid down his life. I'm going to stay away from that. Amen. The removal of sin from the sinner is not a cure-all for those who remain in the body. In other words, something had to, see, God taking away my sin had to happen in order that, see, in order that we could be given the Comforter. See, we could be made one with him. And then now it's when really the work gets started. He took away your sins, but see, now you're going to have to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You're going to have to be conformed into the image of his own Son. Now that's a work there. Now that work didn't require Jesus dying on the cross as much as it did him reigning in heaven. He had to be at the right hand of the majesty on high. He had to send the Holy Spirit on earth. And now they would have his Spirit. They would think like him. They would go to him and he would be able to administer this grace that they would need in order for their sins being put away to be effectual in preparing them for glory. Now that's a big work. He didn't say, Michael, come over here. Now I know my son had to die for sins, but now I'm going to pass the work on over to you because you're a mighty angel and I want you to go out there and you help the people. That isn't what happened. Jesus entered in with his own blood. See, this is personal, with his own blood. So I'm here now, Father, to intercede for my people. I'm going to intercede for them. There's going to be times when on earth it's going to look like I've abandoned them, but I'm going to prove that they're faithful and they're true. Every time you believe, even though it doesn't seem like anything's happened, but you believe anyway. See, you're proving that God has put Christ at his own right hand and he's reigning. You're walking right through the midst of a fiery furnace. And you're coming out without even the smell of smoke on your clothes. Why? Because he's reigning right now. The right hand of God, he's put away, he blotted out your transgressions. Is there something else to be seen here? The consequences of sinning, even though the sins may have been removed through confession and the blood of Christ, the consequences of sinning, they remain embroidered in the flesh of those who sinned. Now, the Bible bears this out. I'm not on my own here. There's something about sinning that requires some kind of reminder of the sinning so you don't go get involved in it again. Now, and there's many illustrations of this in Scripture. I've just chosen a couple that we know. First of all, I want to say Ecclesiastes 11:1 is absolutely true. Cast thy bread upon the waters, for thou shalt find it after many days. Now, there isn't really any way you can get out of this. You say, well, I confess my sin and he took them away, so that's all going to be smooth sailing from here out. Well, that's just a little too simplistic. There's something that God's going to hold you accountable for, even after he's taken your sin away, because, see, we live in a jeopardous world. Well, if God just took it away and then you had no remembrance of it at all, who's to say you wouldn't become involved in it again? Who's to say that this, see, there's something that God's going to do that's going to prevent this. God was teaching his people this principle that you cast your bread out of water and after many days it comes back. See, now, there's a good side to that too, by the way. But see, there's also a negative side to that. Remember Moses? Now, this Moses was a leader of a band of people. Now, he said their necks were hard. These were hard-hearted people. Moses had to lead them anyway. He did. Now, he even had a heart for them. See, he wanted them to learn from their mistakes, but they never did. Flesh, we'll find out that flesh doesn't learn anything. Flesh is untrainable. Flesh will always be flesh. That's why we got to get out. We got to crucify that flesh. Amen. Because if you don't, it'll lead you right back into the same sins that you confessed last week. It'll do it. Flesh doesn't learn anything. But praise God, the new man does. And the new man has dominion over the old man. Now, see, it has to be exercised. Well, we know this. It has to be exercised, but it's there nonetheless. Going back to Moses, God said in Exodus 32:7, and the Lord spake unto Moses, and he says, go, get thee down, for thy people, which thou broughtest out of the land of Egypt, have corrupted themselves. So it wasn't very long at all. Moses is up there on the mountain. He's fellowshipping with God. They're down. And they've corrupted themselves. They've turned aside quickly out of the way which I commanded them. They have made them a molten calf. They have made them a molten calf. And they have worshipped it. And have sacrificed thereunto and said, these be the gods that brought us out of Egypt. These are the ones. You say, well, that would be insane. Well, it's insane to come into Christ and then keep on sinning. That's insane. It's just as insane as that is, isn't it? And the Lord said unto Moses, I have seen this people, and behold, it's a stiff-necked people. Now, therefore, let me alone, that my wrath may wax hot against them, that I may consume them, and I will make of thee a great nation. Oh, Moses, let's get rid of this chaff, and let's just get on with the work. Remember now, this is the same God that said, I have taken away your, have blotted out your transgression. This is the same God. It's not a different God. It's not a God of the old covenant, not a God of the new. It's the same God. He feels the same way about sin. The same God. God hasn't changed at all. In fact, we've already gone over this time and again here. He can't change. He won't change. There's not any circumstance that can force him to change. He's the same. You know the account. I won't go through the whole account because for time, but Moses intercedes for him. He steps up. That's the whole reason that God had him up there anyway. He steps up. He intercedes for him. And then Moses goes down the mount. And what do you know? As soon as he sees it with his own eyes, he has the same reaction that God had. Same reaction. Why? Because something happened to Moses when he was up on top of the mountain. There's something that happened to the believers, too, when they're fellowshipping with Christ in the Holy Spirit. You walk in the Spirit. If you walk in the Spirit, you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Why? Because the same reason that Moses, he came down the mountain and had the same reaction because he had been with God. See, remember he said, I'm going to make a covenant with you. He said, I'm going to be with you. They're going to be my people, and I'm going to be their God. He can put a new spirit in you. You love God and you love the things of God. Okay, now, so he goes down there. He has the same reaction. And then remember, it gets to the point to where he says, who's on the Lord's side? Yeah. And the Levites, they separated themselves and they joined Moses. They were offended too, weren't they? Mm-hmm. All right, so it gets pretty violent. The next scene is like going to be R-rated. It gets pretty violent. Take the swords, and 3,000 men were killed by the sword that day. 3,000, that's what it says. It came to pass on the morrow, after the 3,000 are dead now, 3,000 men dead because they had corrupted themselves. And it came pass on the morrow, Exodus 32:30, that Moses said unto the people, you have sinned a great sin. And now I'll go up to the Lord, peradventure. Maybe. I'm going to go up. I'm going to plead for you, but I can't promise he'll forgive you. See, Moses wasn't one of our contemporaries, was he? No. Moses wasn't like these easygoing preachers of our time that tell people, doesn't make any difference what you do. God loves you just the way you are. Moses said, peradventure. I shall make an atonement for your sins. Moses wasn't even sure at this point if this kind of sin that they had done. See, it was a different kind of sin. Yeah. They sinned against God all over again. They offended God. It seems as though Moses really has nothing to work with here. I mean, Think about it. Put yourself in Moses' place. You're going to go up to a holy God. Now, you've been with him. You know. You've seen him to some degree. And you're going to go up now and you're going to intercede for these people. So he uses the only thing he has. Moses offers himself.
Right.
Look at this. It says, if thou wilt forgive their sin. And then there is no more. Nothing more to that sentence. If you'll forgive them. And if not, blot me, I pray thee, out of the book which thou hast written. Moses works with the only thing he really has. He knows he wasn't involved in that. He knows that. And he works with what he has. And God tells him, whosoever hath sinned against me, whoever has sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book. This is the same God. It says, I blotted out your transgression. Now, God must have had a good reason for doing this. And he did, because Christ took sin on himself. You see what I'm saying? All right, so that's over with, right? That's over with. Moses goes up there. He pleads to the Lord. The 3,000 men died. Moses went up and God tells him, no, he said, that's the way it works. Whoever sins, that's who I'm going to blot out of my book. So that chapter's over. We'll get, no, not really. It's what it says. And the Lord plagued the people because they made the calf, which Aaron made. See, there was something. God's too holy to let this pass, to just let this alone. No, see, they've got to be made aware what they've done. What they've done was much more serious than they dare imagine. So, I mean, just think about it from the people's standpoint. Here Moses goes up, he comes back down, everything's fine. We'll just pretend like this never happened. We'll just pretend like we never sinned. There's a lot of that going on.
Yeah.
But it doesn't make any difference if you pretend that you haven't sinned. You have. David found out. And I too want to be of the number that qualify what I'm getting ready to say. Because David was a man after God's own heart. But David, God had David's transgression written in the book for a valid reason. So we would know and understand how God feels about this stuff. See, this, we got to understand this. This is not something simplistic with God. And David found out that there was a very real cost attached to stealing another man's wife. It was a very real cost, and it was going to be a very personal cost for David. I'm not speaking against the remembrance of David when I say this, as I've already said, but God wanted, he wanted us to understand this. And now, to some degree, David went through this so we would be able to understand.
That's right.
See, I'm sure David looked back on his life and said, why did I do that? How did that happen? God was making him an example for us. So we're living in times when it's all too easy to sin and think God's not going to see it. You want to know about sin? You want to know about adultery? You want to know about fornication? Look at David. God gave us an example. People think they're getting away with it. They're not getting away with it. They are not. And they're going to have to stand before a holy God and say, wait a minute. I bent my knee and I said a few words and it's over with, right? Well, I don't think so. Read about David. It isn't that easy. There's some consequences. You put your hand in the fire and it isn't going to come out the same as it went in.
Amen.
I'm not going to go into the whole account again, but you remember what happened. And after Uriah died, after he was dead, and when the morning passed, David sent and fetched her to his house, and she became his wife and bare him a son. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. He wasn't happy with this. Now, in going through this, I've refreshed my vow. I don't want to displease the Lord.
Amen.
I don't want the Lord to be displeased with me.
Amen.
I don't. If God hasn't changed now, what is God going to do about this? Well, the very next verse in the very next chapter, 2 Samuel 12:1, and the Lord sent Nathan to Daniel. God wasn't going to let this thing go. He sent Nathan to him. He said, I'm going to give him a word. God was not going to allow David to think that everything was just fine. It wasn't. Why? Because God was working with David. God's the one that put him there. God's working with him. See, there was something that had to be done because of this. And God, see, this is the thing, is you can trust God to do the right thing. You can always trust God to do the right thing. Nathan tells David a little story about a lamb, remember? I won't go into the whole thing. You remember, it was going to touch his heart because he was a shepherd. And in the end, David said, whoever it is, he's going to get him. He's going to go after him, wasn't he? Yeah. He said, this isn't right. Of course, Nathan says, yeah, you're right, it wasn't right. And David said unto Nathan, as soon as he knew that he was the man, thou art the man. As soon as David knew it, it hit his heart like a knife. And it's what he said. I have sinned against the Lord. I can see it now. He didn't see it then. If he'd have seen it, if it had come to him while he was on the housetop, he'd have turned around and went inside. I guarantee it. I know David. But he didn't see it. He was kept from seeing this. Why? So we'd have an example. Yeah. And we have it now. So I've sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said unto the Lord also hath put away thy sin. Thou shalt not die. So David says, oh, okay, let's eat dinner. That isn't exactly what happened. David was grieved in his heart. 2 Samuel 12:14. This is right after 13, says, howbeit, there was some consequences that David was going to have to, his sin was put away. That's what he said. Nathan said, put your sin away now. He's done it. He's not going to kill you. Howbeit, because by this deed thou hast given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme. There's a lot of that going on in our time. The child also that is born unto thee shall surely die. Now I know that David probably thought it would be easier if you just kill me. I'm going to have to live with this the rest of my life. Yeah, I can't imagine, David, this was a hard thing. You want to know how God feels about sin? This is how he feels about it. We can see from the words of Nathan to David that the Lord wanted these two things to become as one. He wanted these things to be remembered as one. The Lord does blot out your sins. He does. He does. He's faithful to do it. But there's always a howbeit mixed in there somewhere. It's going to come. You cast the bread on the water and it's going to come back. See, God is not mocked. Whatever a man sows, that's also what he's going to reap. David writes these words for all to read, Psalms 25:7. Remember not the sins of my youth, nor my transgression. According to thy mercy, remember thou me for thy goodness' sake, Lord. Good and upright is the Lord, therefore he'll teach sinners in the way. David knew why, because David had been taught by the Lord about sin. See, it was all, you know, it's all too easy to tell someone, it's all right. It's all right. Don't worry about it. Thank you. Don't worry about it. You know, God loves you just the way you are. And you try to comfort people who don't deserve comfort. No, they don't deserve comfort. They need to repent. Now, the Lord will give them some comfort if they repent. But see, because I repented, just because I... Does that mean it's all going to be smooth sailing? I'm sorry, David will stand up and argue with you about this. He would. God never excuses sin. Never. And neither should we. We should never excuse sin. Say, well, I would never do that. But see, in the moment, see, he said, well, I'm going to comfort them. Well, I know what it means. God never overlooks sin. He never overlooks it. Just says, well, look. I'm not even going to pretend. I'm going to pretend like it's not even there. Well, you can do that, but it's still there. And as representatives of the kingdom of God, I definitely wouldn't suggest you doing that. Overlooking sin. We preach Christ and him crucified. Why? Because he can take away sin. Amen. That's what the message we bring people. If you sinned, repent. Because see, that's when the good stuff can come. But it can't come. It can't come. If you won't repent, God won't bless you. That's just the way it is. The only blessing you're going to get is perhaps you'll be given to repent. That's a blessing.
Yeah,
blessing. I can tell you right now, that's a blessing. The moment we as a congregation or as a church become tolerant of sin, we have completely missed the mandate that the church was given. We don't want to become tolerant of sin. Now, I'm not saying that we should be harsh. I'm saying we shouldn't be tolerant of sin. God's not tolerant of sin. And I don't believe that the Holy Spirit would ever lead anyone to be tolerant of sin. See, the fact is that when you become tolerant of sin, you will lose the respect that a man of God or person of God has to have in order to stand for God. In other words, you won't be effective. See, God's not going to work through somebody who isn't telling the truth. It's not going to work. It's not going to happen. Protect your witness. That's what I was thinking. Protect your witness at all costs. Be known for being someone that hates iniquity, no matter what. We're called to lead people to Christ. Why? We don't just lead them to Christ so they can be comfortable. It's so they can repent. Now we got a lot of good things. If a person will just repent and be sorry for their sin, believe me, God has a whole recovery program. He'll give you some grace. But he's not going to give you some grace if you're going to demand that you hold on to the sin. I praise God that he does it this way. I do, because that means that the sin's been dealt with. Yeah. And now recovery is possible.
Amen.
The Lord tells us that he blots out our transgression, says, for my own sake. Well, think about that a little bit. For my own sake. Some may think that God was remembering David's sin. See, I can see how this could be possible. A person could say, wait a minute now, God. You said you would take away my sin. Now, what's this thing about this? The child dying. What's that? What's that mean? You didn't really take away his sin. Oh, yeah, he did really take away his sin. He really did do it. But there was some implications of the sin. See, now, David, technically God was living out what he taught the people in the law. Now think about this. Now, David took the life of a person that he didn't love. He didn't love Uriah, or he wouldn't have had him killed. God's going to take a person that he does love. That's what he did. Say, well, that's not right. Yes, it is right. It's right. What God did was right. See, this was a punishment that was fitting the crime. Ultimately, God blots out our transgression for his own sake, and that's a very costly transaction. This cost God a lot to put away your sin. He had to turn his back on his own son. He had to make him a curse for us. Because we sinned. Now see, he's showing us something here with David. David so too casually took the life of another man. And God showed him, you can't do that and get away with it. You can't. God took away his sin, but he still made him endure some of the consequences of that sin. Oh, I'm telling you, it wasn't easy for God to look at Christ. This is the one that he loved. This was his own son, and he loved him. And God laid the iniquity of us all on him, and he bore it away. And it, speaking as a man, it broke God's heart. But he did it anyway. Why? Because he wanted to. The purpose that God purposed before the foundation of the world was so great that it was worth the investment. His son came. His son knew in the garden. His son knew exactly what it was going to cost. He counted the cost. Even though his flesh drew back from it, he gathered up his strength and he said, I'm going to the cross for my Father's sake. For my Father's sake. He loved the Father. And he gave his life for us. Why? Because this is the only way he could take away, he could blot out our transgressions. Before Jesus ever gave up the ghost, sins were gone. They were gone. He blotted out our transgressions. And what a cost. What a cost. Laid down his life that we might have life and have it more abundant. So, you know, when God asked me to pass through some judgment because of what I've done, I'll happily do it. How could you possibly hold back from a God that took away all your sins? How could you tell him, I don't deserve this? You've sinned against the holy God. He took your sin away. But sin has changed you. It's modified you. So see, you've got to go through. You've got to remember the cost. And you've got to remember the sinning. Oh, there's penalties to sinning. And there's something that it does to a person that only God can take away. And the experiences that God asks you to go through your life are modifying you to fit into heaven. Yeah. See, this is required. This is absolutely required. If you're going to be a son of God and reign in glory, then every bit of what sin affects into your life has to be gone. It has to be gone. And God asks us to bear up under some of these sufferings of Christ because it's the only thing that'll get the job done. Oh, I'm telling you, this is salvation. David didn't balk. David didn't say, oh, I can't believe it. David didn't do this. Remember, the child became sick. Yeah. And David, he wouldn't eat. He wouldn't eat nothing. He fasted and he prayed. And the moment the child died, he got up and he washed his face and he went in and ate. And his servants, they couldn't believe it. They asked him, how can you do this? He said, while the child was alive, there was hope. He said, the child can't come to me, but I can go to him, right? Yeah. Well, ultimately, see, this is all part of seeing that God's taken away your iniquity for his own sake. In other words, God took away your sin because of his eternal purpose. All right, there's an eternal purpose that he's working out. In order for him to work it out, your sin had to be gone. It had to be gone before he could work in you to bring about this purpose. All right, so during the process of that, you're going to be called upon to live. All right, now that's going to hurt, you know, when you have to live for Christ in a world like this. But if you do it, well, then you'll be transformed. All the trials, they're for a reason. It's not like God just saying, well, all right, you know, like they portrayed the Greek gods up there and they were just making them do things so they could laugh at them. There's a reason that you have to go through tribulation. It's working in you. It's doing something in you. I thought of this song while I was doing this. Must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free?
No.
No, there's a cross for everyone and there's a cross for me. Oh, precious cross. When you see the cross for what it is, you'll say, oh, precious cross. Oh, glorious crown, oh, resurrection day. Ye angels from the stars come down and bear my soul away. As soon as God's done working in you, you'll get to go home. It's just a short while. But if you submit to what God leads you into, you'll not only glorify God, but you'll help to prepare yourself for that eternal city. This, it makes more sense then when you see scripture like this, Proverbs 27:5, open rebuke is better than secret love. What does that mean? That doesn't mean I like to be rebuked. It means I can understand that when I have to be rebuked, it's for a reason. See, ministers of God, We've been sent to people and minister for God. And I'm sure Nathan didn't want to bring that message. I'm sure there was a part of him that just, it broke his heart to have to go tell David this. But he did it. Why? Because he was God's minister. Yeah. Having to bear the recollection of sins of our past, it's not easy. But see, I know, I've experienced this, that I didn't fully repent like I should have. I didn't know what I know now. And as God brings these things up, it's so I can see, wait a minute, I offended God a lot more than I thought I did. And see, you can repent for it. You can say, God brings them up for a reason. He allows us to suffer through them. He allows us. It's a privilege when you see it right. And it's only for here. It's only for here. You've sinned in the earth, and it's only for here. See, when this vile body hits the ground, then you could be off running with the Lord. You could make some real progress then. Here in the days of our flesh, see, we need this. We need tribulation and trial. Now, I'm not a tribulation trial monger. I pray just what the Lord says, lead me not into temptation. Deliver me from the evil, because I don't want to go through even one trial that I don't have to. And you know, men do bring trials on themselves that they don't have to go through. Yeah. Yeah. They do, you know, some men do die before their time. You know, you can be foolish and pay the price for it and still go to heaven. I hope you understand what that meant. David put it like this in Psalm 79:8. Now remember, he's been conditioned now. This is what he had to go through. It conditioned him. It made him stronger. He never did it again, right? Never. That's what he said. Oh, remember not against us former iniquities. He's pleading with the Father. Don't hold this against us. God doesn't. But he still pled it anyway, right? Let thy tender mercy speedily prevent us. Speedily. Let this remembrance help me to never get involved in that again. Never. For we are brought very low. Help us, O God of our salvation, for the glory of thy name. God's doing it for his own glory. See, now, when we're brought into the same, like Moses, he saw things like God saw things. So see, now when you see things like God sees things, and you look back, see, you'll be able to repent more perfectly, if I can say it that way. Purge away our sins for thy name's sake. Do it for thy name's sake, Lord. See, now this is a good way to plead with the Lord. David knew firsthand of the mercy of the Lord. Nathan did tell David that the Lord had put away his sins. So like I said, this is hard for some people to reason out, because they're like, he put away his sin, but then he had to go through these hard things because of his sin? Yeah, he did. And he did it with a good heart. But that isn't all that he told him. Now, I thought about, well, should I read this? And I thought, well, it's in there, so I guess I better read it. This is what Nathan said to David right before he told him, I put away your sin. Now, therefore, the sword shall never depart from your house, because thou hast despised me. Now see, David probably didn't know that while he was sinning. David probably didn't think, I'm despising God. But he was. And has taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be thy wife. Thus saith the Lord, behold, I will raise up evil against thee out of thine own house. God said that. I'm gonna raise up evil against you, because you despised me and you took Uriah's wife. This is the same God that we serve today. And I will take thy wives before thine eyes and give them unto thy neighbor, and he shall lie with thy wives in the sight of this son. But thou didst it secretly, but I will do this thing before all of Israel and before the sun. I'm going to do this publicly. This is God. I don't think... that a day went by when David didn't remember this. This didn't echo in his ear. I mean, we know it just from the testimony that his own children rose up against him. Oh, this was it. David's life was a hard life. He, before he ever had any sons, his life was a hard life. He was a man of war. And I don't think David was casual with God. I think David had a respect for what God did. I mean, this was hard. This was a hard thing to have to live with. Now, we all know that there's things in our life that we've had to endure because we sinned. And yet we know. See, if you know that God's put them away, that your sin's been dealt with, then having to endure what David got right here. Yeah. See, you know God's with me now. I can endure it if you're with me. And see, this is what, so all the Psalms that David wrote are like this. I know you're with me. See, he was asking God to hold me up. I know I have to go through this because you told me I have to go through this. But he was dependent on God giving him grace to be able to go through it and honor God in it. Like I said, it's just for this world. Now, David, I wanted to say this about David. Because this is what God said about David. After all this was over, David did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord and turned not aside from anything that he commanded him all the days of his life, save only in the matter of Uriah the Hittite. I can't say that. And I'm living under the new covenant. So see, I thought, I was convicted of that. If this man under the law, the only thing God held against him was this one thing. See, in Christ Jesus, we've been given a lot more. We have. And so we're going to be held responsible for a lot more. In closing, I want to give a new covenant application. I mean, if you get high enough, and I thought I would say this, I think, in fact, I know the brother here will receive it. But if you can get high enough, God used David to teach us about himself. Yes. See, this is, we owe David a great debt. He went through some things that were very difficult things. But God set him up there like an example so that we could know that God, he's the one that puts away our transgressions. But see, that it's a little more complicated than that. In closing, I want to think about this. God does, in fact, forgive our transgression, but there are some temporal effects and implications to those who sin and to those who are actively doing the works of righteousness. See, I don't want to just be one-sided. We sin and there's implications. But we do righteousness. Oh, there's implications there, too. Galatians 6:5 says, "For every man shall bear his own burden." Amen. I like that. Every man, you have a burden that you have to bear. Let's don't make the brethren bear it with you, if you can understand what I'm saying. Every man shall bear his own burden. Let him that is taught in the word communicate unto him that teacheth in all good things. Like we learned from David. God used David to teach us something. But they didn't stop there, did it? I mean, how much of the new covenant did you learn from David? I learned so many things from Paul. Paul's been like I can't communicate to Paul. Well, yeah, you can. You can give yourself to what he said. See, God's taken away our sins. Like I said, that was the first step. In order that we might be workers of righteousness. See, we could walk with God and sin not. There's a lot more to being saved than just having your sins taken away. I mean, that has got to happen, but that's, I don't think you're going to be able to stay away from that if you don't progress in the Lord. It also says this, "He that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap everlasting life or life eternal. So that this is a big thing. I mean, you say, well, you cast your bread on the water and it's coming back. We've seen this in David, how it did. We know in our own lives how it did. But what about working the works of righteousness? What about living for the Lord? That has ramifications too. And you know your sin has touched other people. Well, how about your righteousness? Has it touched other people? Well, yeah, it has. You live righteous for the Lord and it'll touch other people. The apostle gives this exhortation. Says, let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. See, nobody may never see you do something for the Lord. You may do it in secret. You may do all things heartily as unto him and not as unto men. And the Lord saw it. And the Lord's going to, what is he going to do? Remember, David did something in secret. And the Lord rewarded him publicly. Well, you live your life for the Lord, even in secret. And he's going to reward you publicly. It's coming back. The same God that blotted out our transgression wants us to know that because our sins are gone, we can be actively sowing to the Spirit. This is what we can do. We have the liberty to be able to live for God now. And if anyone tries to stop you, if even the devil tries to get it, my sins are gone. I got nothing to do with you. I'm sowing to the Spirit. Well, we want good things to be coming back. See, now, the good thing about sowing to the Spirit is those rewards are not limited to time. See, you sow to the Spirit and you're going to be reaping for all eternity. That's pretty big. See, God took away our sins so that we could be active with him now and reap the benefits in the world to come. Well, that's pretty good. I think I'm just going to close there. Joel said, I'll restore unto you the years that the locusts have eaten. That's what Joel said. This is what God's going to do now. He's going to restore the years. You think back, you say, well, I got some years that I wasted. He can restore them. God can do it. He will. Amen. And the canker worm and the caterpillar and the palmer wood and my great army which I set among you. And ye shall eat in plenty. This is our God now. He said, in salvation, you're good. I'm gonna remove the reproach. Oh, this is good. It shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. This is the God now that we become. Christ is bringing us to this God. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance. You've been delivered. Well, I thank the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. He's taken away, blotted out. Like Sister Anita was talking about, blotted them out. Blotted them out, yeah. In his sight, they're not there anymore. Amen. They're gone.